Hallo, assalamu alaikum, good morning, khushamdeed. Ji aya nu khuyumorge ispata.
Pakhair agle, ni hao, tunashamme, washmale, ohayak, genzaimus, guten morgen, hola, bonjour, privyet, kaifahal, alishuma chatore, ahlan wasalan, marhaba, buna, mucho, gracias, suaviyab, balli kare aya. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for tuning in to PTV World. You're definitely watching World This Morning alongside my very amazing, wonderful human being co-host. She happens to be Miss Shiza Hashmi, and I happen to be Shahzad Ehsan Khan. And we hope and pray that everybody out there is ready to kickstart their day with us. Hello, Shiza. How are you doing today?
I'm doing absolutely great. Thank you so much for asking. You guys, before we move on, I have a super amazing good news to share with all of you. Shahzad Khan over here is Pakistan's first, I mean, top anchor or host for private and, well, the other events as well. Congratulations on that.
Thank you very much, Shahzad.
Well deserved it, Shahzad. There's definitely no doubt in that. And for some reason, I have no idea. I feel so proud. I mean, I feel really,
proud.
And I'm so happy for you, mashallah.
Thank you very much for saying that. And shukr alhamdulillah in the first place. And it's all because of all of those people who are out there, who've been continuously supporting.
You have a cult following now.
Yeah, alhamdulillah, shukr, alhamdulillah, and it obviously gives me a lot of pleasure, and I want to thank a lot and my parents for that, alhamdulillah. But I think at the same time, I'll feel a lot more pressure because even now today, I think people will be like, okay, acha, you know, wonderful host. Let's see, you know, what he's got under the belt. But ladies and gentlemen, I think it's just because of the perseverance, dedication,
absolutely,
and not stopping at what you always love to do as well. So I think Allah always gave me that opportunity. A lot of people ask me this, Shiza, as well, that, you know, sir, how do you do this? You know, one day we check your Snapchat, you're in Karachi, the next day you're in Lahore, and the next day you're in Bhurban. So ladies and gentlemen, I feel as if, you know, whenever somebody asks you to host a show for them, I feel as if it's an opportunity from Allah Almighty. And God forbid, if you're going to decline such an opportunity once or twice, Allah might not even feel good about it, that, you know, hey, you know what, I'm actually giving you work and you're not willing to do so. So obviously somebody else who's more deserving will definitely get a chance. So please make sure that you're on your toes and continue to strive for excellence. Well, that's it for me. What about Chi, Shiza? What do you have to say?
Well, about this staying on the same page, I want to say something. I feel like, so for all the people out there who are definitely following Shahzad for so many years now, for quite some years now, because he's been an actor.
I think that's going to happen to me now.
No, not really. But mashallah, you've been an actor, you've been a host. Anyway, my point was, there are some of the, better qualities that I have noticed in you, of course. And you and me, we always talk about, fruitful traits sort of to develop as a nation so Pakistan can be better. So I'm going to point two of them out to you guys. So maybe we can all together adopt them and be like Shahzad.
Let's do that.
All right. So it's sort of or more or less related to the book of the 7 Habits of Successful People.
Yeah.
So remembering those two of the ones on top of my mind with you are definitely you have that abundance mentality.
Shukran.
So with Shahzad, whatever he gets, mashallah, mashallah, he will make sure to share it with me first of all. I'm not going to speak on behalf of other people, but with me, always, I think for almost every single event, he's asking, whenever there's a chance, he's asking me, which makes us believe that you have such a big heart, mashallah. And people who do have a big heart, Allah gives them unlimited, of course.
Thank
there's
you.
Definitely not an upper limit.
Stop it, I'm going to cry.
Okay, so let's hold it there as well. This one habit, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to all adopt today. Because abundance mentality is something that will take you so further as well. And sort of, you know, put your anxiety and panic to a rest too.
Exactly.
Just to believe that there's enough for everyone out there.
Thank you very much for saying that. And Shiza, I would love to build up on this as well. Because people usually get very insecure. You know, they're like, okay, God forbid, you know, if I'm going to take her with me on a show, you know, what if she performs well, you know, they might not even call me the next time. So I think everybody's got their own place, and this is something which I want Pakistanis to understand.
Yes.
I think in all priority, I want people to kind of understand that your risk is by Allah Almighty. So
Absolutely.
Please make sure that you do not kind of confuse yourself by thinking that, hey, you know what, he's taking that much. Why am I not getting anything and things like that? So everything's from Allah. For the last 2 years, we were just at home. We weren't doing anything.
Oh, yes.
And imagine that all of a sudden when the work picked up, alhamdulillah, I've been nominated as one of the best 6 hosts, you know, for all of those people who've been nominated. I think it's important at the same time to name all of those people as well. So there's Sophia Anjum, there's Ahmed Ali Bhatt, there's Dino Ali, and then there's Sidra Iqbal, and then there's Anusha Ashraf as well. And inshallah, you know, because Shiza's actually on that journey now, I think inshallah somewhere next year around, we'll be talking about Shiza being in that list as well.
Thank you so much. But yes, now I'm on the journey because you have given me the confidence as well.
Yeah, and do you want me to share, you know, that conversation which I had with you over the phone? I mean, only if you're going to allow me to do so.
Okay, I don't remember.
All right, so ladies and gentlemen, so what happens is that whenever somebody calls me, they're like, we need a female co-host as well. So I was like, do you want me to suggest or do you want to do it on your own? So they're like, sir, you suggest because we want you to be comfortable on stage. So my first ever priority, ladies and gentlemen, obviously, because, you know, we've been working together for the last 3-4 years. I'm like, hey, you know what? She's a Hashmi. She's a great host and whatnot. And she's got some wonderful profile made. She made one for me as well. And then I called her. So we did a show. We got back. And then there was another show. She couldn't go, unfortunately. But then there was another show. And I was like, Shiza, do you want to do this? And she was like, I don't know. I'm still thinking and all of that. So all of a sudden, I said, hey, you know what? For the last 2 years, we haven't been doing anything. I think it's about time that we put our heads down and just start working. So she was like, yeah, I think I'm going to do it now.
I swear, these were the exact words. And I was not sure because, I mean, of course, it's a public event. I was like, Shahzad, I've done one with you, but I don't think it's my comfort zone. I don't think I can do it. He goes like, listen, you're being thankless. You know, for 2 years, we've been wishing. So, yeah, and I feel like, Shahzad, this is the part of the pandemic that you and I are facing because we're hosts.
Exactly.
But I think the pandemic hit everyone differently.
True.
And because it's been on for more than 2 years now, a lot of people have been locked in their houses more than they've ever been at their houses.
True.
You know, because there was no option. They had no choice, right?
Yeah.
So I feel like this was the time a lot of family members were even sort of coming to know each other as well. And you know what a common sense... while it's funny, can I tell you, it's real.
Yeah.
Because imagine even the teenagers or, you know, youngsters for that matter.
Yeah.
They have internet. It's the fifth generation warfare that's continuously going on as well. They rarely come out of their bedrooms.
Yes.
So now, because everything had to be centralized in a house system, a lot of a very common sentiment that my youngest sister, she's a teenager, she and her friends shared with me were, Shazapi, I don't think we think the same like our parents. Or, you know, they don't understand us. They have the simplest line to say always. They don't understand where we're coming from. I was like, you tell me, where are you coming from?
Yeah.
But that made me realize, definitely, you know, there's difference of opinion. There's so many factors that might contribute to this miscommunication between teenagers and parents.
Exactly. And we certainly want to build up on this as well. But ladies and gentlemen, you know, such things actually occur on very different levels as well. So imagine that all of a sudden our government started to think that, hey, you know what? We really need to make an example where how and when and where can we actually use all of that plastic which we are dumping because it's not going to go anywhere. So
about
imagine,
time.
Yes,
about
yes,
time
yes about time, that. Alhamdulillah. So there's a model over here in Islamabad, ladies and gentlemen. The name of the road is Ataturk Avenue. So if you go over there, you know, the government actually took this initiative where what they have done is that...
The other day, the minister actually did launch or rather inaugurate this road as well. And they say while it's the first, it's definitely not the last. And a lot of other cities are going to learn from
follow,
this model.
Yeah.
Yes, and follow the model as well.
And you know, Shiza talking to media, he said that the construction of plastic road would decelerate the spread of pollution in the region. He said the initiative was aimed at reducing impact of environmental pollution caused by plastic waste. Sheikh Rashid Saab said the concept would not only be utilized in Islamabad, but would also be replicated in other cities of the country. He appreciated Capital Development Authority Chairman Amir Ali Ahmed for initiating plastic road project in the federal capital. Wow. I mean, with all of these initiatives, it looks like as if, you know, we are shoulder to shoulder with all of those developed countries out there as well. And I think that this is the way forward. And this is one thing which I want to talk about today. Because this is something I have seen. You know, people will always, different walks of people will always have different opinion. And we need to respect that. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm a witness to that for a longer period of time, the use of technology was actually missing somewhere within the procedures of the government offices as well.
In our country.
So imagine that, you know, there's this application with the name of City Islamabad. You can pay your tokens. You can get your car registered. You can report any harassment cases. You know, so there's a long list of whatever you want to do. You can do it as well. And imagine, since there's no paperwork, so there's no delay. You know, and you know, you really do not have to go to an officer and be like, hey, sir, I want to do this. And then the officer would be like, jaye pehle ye 10 photocopy kara ke laye, and then get them attested and whatsoever, which was very time consuming. So I think that the credit goes to PTI government that they have taken all of these initiatives where they have incorporated tech into day-to-day or procedures as well and in daily lives, which I think is great. You can even book a metro ticket from your cell phone as well.
How brilliant.
So I think it's great.
Yeah, definitely. It's so great. It's definitely greater or even a better idea for the newer generation. But with these sort of advancements and whatnot, Shahzad, which is, of course, we want to be at par with the world as well, don't you feel like we need some schooling for a certain elder segment of our society? I mean, I know, I don't mean
I mean,
to
I don't know how they might feel, you know.
I don't mean to be rude, what I mean to say is, definitely, because they did not grow up with technology or gadgets in their hand, right?
Yeah.
So the age or the time period where they were, they had their own personal gadgets and a phone that was not universal for the entire family, imagine for that matter, was probably in the late 90s or early 2000s as well. So they had to, the first 40 to 50 years of their life, they had to unlearn them to be on the track of the newer technology.
Imagine.
Don't you think that might sort of create a dissonance in the in those two generations?
Obviously, there's this gap as well, and this is something, ladies and gentlemen, which we want to talk about. We want to talk about generation gap today and how to kind of bridge that. Because in days to come, you know, Shiza has actually put it very rightly. Imagine that I have seen that wooden box where the landline telephone goes into it, and then, you know, there's a cover on top of it, and then it's been locked.
Why is it
so
locked?
That because it was expensive back in those days as well, and so you could only receive calls, but you cannot call, right? So then you actually have to put something inside to dial the number because father wasn't home, and then there was a code on those phones as well,
yes.
So that nobody can actually call internationally as well. So for all of these advancements, ladies and gentlemen, people from different walks of life have had and have been facing all of these gaps as well. Imagine that a 13 or a 14 year old is earning millions just by sitting at home and working on their laptop, where we, you know, selling cars or doing shows or whatever. I think in days to come, they will be looking down upon us and be like, hey, you know what? Since they do not know what we are doing, I think they're only best at what they're doing already. So, you know, that's the gap in between. We really need to talk about it. So how to go about it is something we're going to talk. First of all, everybody's got a different definition of generation gap. What it is, we have three different people from different walks of life, and we want them to kind of let us know what generation gap is and how then we can bridge it is something we'll be talking about. It's a very vast topic though, but let's see what our guests have to say. We are very apt guests over here in the studios with us. Ladies and gentlemen, we are very lucky that we've actually been joined by a faculty member of PIAS, and he happens to be Dr. Sajjad Tahir. Hello, sir. Assalamu alaikum. Subah bakhair. How are you?
Wa alaikum assalam. Good, alhamdulillah.
Thank you very much, sir, for joining us. Wonderful to have you.
Thank you very much.
Alongside Dr. Sajjad Tahir, ladies and gentlemen, we are very thankful. Main shukriya ada karta hun. Shukriya ga ke wo hamare program mein. Thank you very much, Shukriya. We have with us Shukriya Qasim Khan, ladies and gentlemen. She happens to be a psychologist at PIAS as well. Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam, and thank you very much.
Thank you very much for joining us. Wonderful to have you, and I like your coat. It's fantastic. The color is great
thank
as
you.
Well.
Absolutely.
Wonderful.
Like
I'm looking one for myself as well, but I still cannot get my hands onto. But last but not the least, ladies and gentlemen, just before the show, me and Shiza was saying that God forbid if both of us cannot show up on the show, our producer Jamshed Sultan Saab can actually call this gentleman and be like, hey, you know what? Yeah, my anchors are not coming. Can you come in? Whenever he speaks, he always makes sense.
Absolutely.
He always makes sure that it's backed with logic and that, you know, there's a greater understanding and that whatever words he's going to use will actually have an impact and that people will utilize it towards a very positive feel as well. So, ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, he's a former UN officer as well. He's a motivational speaker. He is Muhammad Abdul Wahab Saab. Hello, sir. Assalamu alaikum. Good morning.
Wa alaikum assalam, Shahzad. Thank you so much for your super beautiful words. At the same time, I must congratulate you. You know, your achievement is really tremendous. And you really have been working too hard with that enthusiasm and zeal, you know, for long.
Thank you very much,
sir. At the same time, I want to appreciate for the brilliant selection of the topic today.
Thank you.
You see, I mean, this is something we haven't talked about much.
Exactly. But, sir, before we talk about that, there's this one simple question which does not have anything to do with the topic. I want to ask that. So, sir, for all of those people who are motivation speakers, because we've introduced you as a motivation speaker and you happen to be a good one, you know, you go out, you know, in conferences and halls and different offices as well, where you're motivating somewhere in the police academy, you know, somewhere in the bureaucracy as well and whatnot, and you tell them that how to kind of strive towards excellence. So does this motivation speaking actually kind of help you at home as well, or tum to bas chup hi kar do, something like that?
Very, very pertinent question, you know. When you ask this question, I can feel the pinch, you know, inside, because every one of us faces the same thing.
Iska origin what pinch, I'm telling you.
Whatever we are outside, you see, yeah. I mean, usually what happens, our better halves, they also have to they live their lives with that domination, you know. So once they accept that what you're doing outside is brilliant,
yeah,
So they are really not able to dominate in that way. So they really want to keep you at the pace, you know, which is really, I mean, mediocre. But anyway, I mean, this continues to happen throughout the world.
Yeah.
So this is the fact which we have to live with.
Exactly. And sir, the sole reason why I actually asked you this question is because at home, I'm just a host as well. You know, ho kya tum? Hosti to? You know, things like that.
You but, know, the other, August,
yeah,
sorry.
Go ahead if you want to say something.
So, yeah, I mean, people don't respect you at home, no matter what you become. You can become the prime minister,
yeah.
Your family. I think, but that's also the beauty of it, right? The
yeah, exactly.
Keeps
exactly.
you grounded.
Yeah,
the other day, my mom goes like, hey, you know, do this. I was like, you do it yourself. I'm so lazy. She goes like, "Anchory nikalungi main tumhari."
And you know, the beautiful thing is, once you move out of your home with so many titles, what happens? There are various degrees of protocols as well.
Yeah.
So whatever, I mean, you interact, whoever you interact with, you're not natural because of those expectations from you. So what happens? I mean, home is like a heaven. Where whatever you are outside, how much important you are, that doesn't matter. Inside, you are a pure person.
Yes.
And you are loved because of that factor, you know. So
exactly.
This is something which we should appreciate.
But sir, the sole reason why I actually asked you this question is because we want each and every one of you to kind of answer this one. Because this thought is that now, for example, if you go back in time, even then, you know, if your chacha or dada or anybody was a PN at office or work, their wives couldn't utter a word in front of them, you know. They're like, oh, the choi sahab aage nahi, choi sahab aste cha banani, you know, things like that. That was the kind of respect men used to get at that time, you know, or husbands for that matter, or beera aage, or brothers, you know. So for everybody to understand, because this is how it was culturally. Beere liye kukkar banao, you know. And back in those days, I still remember the chicken was actually... chicken was cooked on a festive occasion.
Yes.
Exactly. Things like that. So what I want you to kind of tell us that what generation gap is, how do you think that, you know, that the generation gap has existed over the years, and what was that one thing which was so wrong that we couldn't actually bridge that gap so far? So for all three of you, because you come from different walks of life, I want different answers. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much. मैं तो ये समझता हूँ generation gap when I'm looking at when I'm looking at my age, like when I was young and what my parents was thinking and imposing something on me, and I was thinking that my parents are thinking like they are lacking something what I'm thinking right now, and same thing is happening right now with me when I'm parent and what my children's want to be like, what they want to start and what they want to do right now, and I am imposing some sanctions on them that you should, for example, like if I impose the screen time on them, that you should reduce your screen time, you should not be sitting all the time at the screen, you should play outside, do some exercises and something like that.
Yep.
But they don't want to. They want to sit. They want like one of my child, like he loves to read books and all the time, even on the screen or the real books, like in paper. But I used to advise him all the time that please spare some of your time for your physical exercises as well. You should have some gym, you should have some other activities, you should socialize with the other peoples. You are learning something that, but you are not applying it in your life. You should do that for, and he is thinking that, please give me some time so that I could learn, and then when I will have a chance, I will apply them. So there is a generation gap in like my thinking and my children's. Actually, they are actually, what I'm thinking is like they think that they are like they need to move fast. They need to move fast and they need to cope with the technology.
Sir, I'm sorry, but I think I have to stop you over here just to ask, do you think, okay, because from what you're saying is, I think that you actually think inside your own mind that whatever I'm saying is right for the children, right? This is one thing you
yep.
think.
I think
this
like
is
that.
One of the best causes of generation gap, because they're like, hey, you know what, every time they know what's good for us, how come we do not know what's good for us as well? I think that's one point.
Yep.
And we'll come back to this as well. I'll move on to Ms. Shukriya. So Ms. Shukriya, obviously, first of all, your definition of what generation gap is, and then why do parents think ke jo hum soch rahe wohi theek hai?
Okay, if I would like to say something
sure.
To your first, like what you said, this is male dominating society, you ask about their opinion, that how you are treated in your at
they
your home after going back to the from your workplace, but you didn't ask me.
I mean, for women, I think it can be different as well. I didn't want you to put myself in risk. I'll be like, I don't know what the
my
other.
My experience is totally opposite.
Alhamdulillah, please. Which is why we actually made you sit in the center so that you're the center of the program.
So, yeah. First, I would like to give my response because I'm the first university graduate in my family. I belong to tribal belt.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Which
so
area do you belong?
My children feel proud. My husband feel proud. He is always very supporting. And he sent me to US all alone. You can say taking care of children, of house.
Yeah.
Wow. He sent me to Malaysia, to Indonesia for my career building, for everything.
Yeah.
And I'm the only, you know, who is in my professional life. So, and when I go back home, you know, I'm cared like
exactly my point, because husbands do always, support their wives.
Yes.
But eventually when they come back home, I think it's otherwise as well. On a lighter note, people these days are very judgmental. I don't want people to judge. It's just on a lighter note, just so that anybody and everybody can smile. If there are women not smiling as of now, I think there'll be men smiling within what I said and what ma'am said. I think there are a lot of women who
But
will
I
be
remember I used to go to the school escorted by Kalashnikov because my uncles never let me go to school. My father died when I was only 12 years old. This is how I went to school.
But that also sort of makes me appreciate your uncles in a way, coming from where you are. And in that era to study, to be honest, not a lot of women were doing that.
But my uncle never let me. That was my elder brother who died last year.
He
used
to
stand
definitely.
In front of us holding the Kalashnikov that my sister is going to the school.
Wow.
So this is how, and what Dr. Wahab said, that how our lives are influencing them. It is all subliminal. Though we are not much influential at our home, but our whatever we are offering services to the outer world, it has subliminal effect to our family as well.
It does.
If we are serving the humanity honestly and wholeheartedly, it does have effect on our family, you know. We are getting the reward from home as well. Yes.
I want you to explain this further. How does it impact our family, whatever we go giving out
like,
in the world?
Like I'm, you can say I'm dealing the youth.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm psychologist. I'm serving the youth since more than 10, 11 years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm listening to their problems. I'm solving their issues. So I'm being rewarded by Allah, you know. The same, you know, my own children. They are getting the same reward, subliminal impact they are getting at home.
And that's something which I totally agree to as well. We actually have to head out towards a short report, but I agree to this because, in our household, we usually kind of hear our mothers and fathers saying that, you know, it is all because of your dada buz and dadi ammi's prayers, or, you know, nana buz and nani ammi's prayers and their sacrifices. Because back in those days, ladies and gentlemen, since we were talking about generation gap, imagine, so my grandfather actually kind of got his three sisters married, and then he made houses for them as well.
Mashallah.
Didn't had a bigger house for himself, but so he had a smaller house. But for whatever he was earning, it was a joint family system, and he would spend it on to his younger siblings' education and whatnot. So imagine if they are going to have a good life, every time they will definitely say a prayer for whoever actually helped someone as well. But a small and a simple report on generation gap, ladies and gentlemen. Go ahead, take a listen. When you guys will come back, we'll be like, why are things changing so rapidly? Why have we moved from joint family system to a nuclear family unit as well? And what are the benefits of it? What kind of privacy are we looking for? What do we have to get out of it? And by just staying alone, I mean, living together. Just yesterday, I was thinking this, that, you know, usually I would go back home and I would see my chachu's car outside my house, and I would be so happy that chachu is here.
As a kid.
Yeah.
As a kid.
And Khala is here. Even now, if my chachu is here and I just go outside my house and I'm like, oh, chachu ki gaadi khadi hai, so I'll be more excited. Why are things changing? Why aren't we living together? I want to live together. But this small report about generation gap, please take a look.
Yeah, let's do it.
We leave opinion and thoughts of two different generations. Somehow in generation gap, people find it difficult to agree with the opinion of different generation. It takes place because of the lack of attributes to make each other understand and agree on common grounds. Therefore, it is considered as a big issue by almost every advanced generation. Especially when it comes to 20th and 21st century, then we can see that there has been a rapid changes in the mindset of the people as well as in the technologies. In today's era, lives of people changes in every 10 years. One of the most common cause of generation gap is communication gap. Generally, what happens is children always remain busy with their digital gadgets and thus they don't have any time for their parents. And this communication gaps become generation gap. The phenomena has impacted our daily life quite immensely. Lack of understanding in the relation of parents and children cause daily family disputes and disrespect. We can bridge the generation gap by creating a safe environment for people to express themselves. We must understand and accept each other for what they are rather than fitting them in the box. And if we talk about the other side of the picture, every day we are introduced to some new technological developments that has made the children teachers of their own parents who are dependent on their children when it comes to operate latest technology. We cannot barely blame technological advancement as a cause of gap between generations. We need to find out the root cause and address it in a more positive way.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, so getting rid of all the gaps, I think it's about time that we kind of come down to a point where, okay, you know, what is generation gap? So Ms. Shukri actually spoke about, you know, how she went to school with Kleshnikovs and her brother used to kind of be there and protect her. Obviously, her kids now are, you know, free to go wherever they want to go as well. But you wanted to complete,
please. Yes. When we talk about what is generation gap, it refers to a chasm. You can say it's a mile long fissure,
right,
that separates, you know, a group of people that belongs to different generations, you know. Okay. Now, if we talk about what is generation is a time period where the people born, they live together, they grow up. It's a time period, okay? Then again, if we talk about now, sociologists have you can say worked on the generations, they have studied. We have more than five generations. We have baby boomers, mm-hmm. We have Generation X, we have Generation Y, we have Generation Z.
And Z.
Yes, so as we belong to Generation X.
I belong to X.
Yes, I belong to X. Generation.
No. We are coming across Generation Alpha even. True. Those who are born after 2015.
Exactly.
So look at, so how, now, if we say why there is generation gap, because it is the first time in the history that five generations are living together, side by side. True. They are working together, side by side.
And all of them
side.
Have a voice.
The only thing is that the communication styles are different. Hmm. And so the thing which is bringing a gap between them is the different style of communications.
Okay. Right. You know? Okay.
So the thing is the communication gap between them.
Well, it might not only be communication gap.
Among other things, of course.
Okay. But no. If we look at the real generation gap, it is basically the psychological and emotional gap.
How so?
When we define the generation gap, basically it is the gap of the thoughts. It is the difference of thought.
Yeah, that's true.
Right. It is the difference of action. Mm. It is the difference of belief system.
True.
It is the difference of taste even. Mm. The way the new generation dress up.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
The old generation is not accepting that.
Or the way Palak Alu was, you know, just a few generations ago.
Yes,
I think nobody wants that today. Palak Alu.
Because the adolescents are more, you know, they're influenced by the society. The world is developing, but the old generation is, you know, they are
sort of rigid.
Yes, they are culturally anchored in one time period.
Huh.
And the coming up generations are, you know, they are anchored.
They're exploring, you know, they have more avenues to explore as well, which is great. And we'll come back to this point as well. But Bahab Saab, let's have a roundup of what you think generation gap
I would like to simplify, you know, the whole concept. The thing is, the difference in thinking, perception, reaction, idiosyncrasy, concepts among different age groups is called generation gap. So in order to simplify with a simplified example, in a home there is a grandfather, there is a father and son.
Yeah.
these three people belong to three generations.
Yeah.
All these three people hold different opinions, different outlooks, different perceptions. They react differently. They perceive things differently. They analyze things differently. You bring a gadget, for example, you bring a laptop to home,
yeah,
and you offer your grandpa to sort of make a financial statement of whatever he is doing,
yeah,
or you ask him to please put, things, for example, he wants to write a paragraph in order to express his opinion. So what will happen, he will certainly need a typist. True. You see, because at his age, when he was functional, he didn't have sort of these gadgets where everybody was used to typing. True. You see, well, when the son asked his father, there could be a sort of mixed reaction. If father has been or is working at a competitive place where he has a sort of an environment where people are there with upgraded skills, mm-hmm, he would be able to type. He would be able to type, or someone may not be able to type.
Right.
But when it comes to son,
yeah,
he understands all the complexities of that laptop of or computer.
Yeah.
So right, he can explain almost everything. You ask him to make a PowerPoint presentation, he can do that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You want him to ask something in Word, he will do that. He want some graphics, he will do that. You want some computation, he will be readily available to do that.
Mm.
So this is something, but at the same time, right now when I said this, it says that this transition from older to younger is positive. In some cases, it is negative as well.
Because
the grandpa, who has lived in an age where there was more tolerance, patience, there was more understanding, people used to love each other, people used to have better understanding among themselves, mm, people used to sort of get united, you know. So whenever he will talk with that perception, and he will always talk about unity. He may talk about unity and diversity, but when the father will talk, he will have a sort of, mixed perceptions. Because he might be having something better from that past.
True.
At the same time, the negativities which are impacting this generation, whatever negative trends he is watching today. That's so right.
Or those trends might be only negative in his own mindset.
Exactly.
You know, I think that's what we're talking about, right?
Yeah, you're right. But when son sees the world, he basically sees the outer world, whatever he has seen or whatever he is experiencing. Unfortunately, what is happening, we have developed technologically. We have got all the latest gadgets in our hands. We have got life quite simplified. Everything has squeezed to
our palm.
Phone. You can order anything. You can ask for anything. You can get any facility.
Exactly.
But what is happening? We have paid a huge cost.
That's true.
You know, family bondings have really gone down. Our frustrations, our psychological problems, they have increased. We do not communicate. You see, so we have sort of allocated our lives to social media in a way.
True.
While we have almost divorced our family lives, you see, and we have allocated ourselves almost 90% of the lives to social media. So what is happening? This generation is technologically quite advanced. They are very sharp. They can find solutions to most complex problems, which perhaps two generations ago it was impossible. But what is happening emotionally and socially, this present generation is too weak.
And Abdul,
we have to blame ourselves for that, basically.
Yeah.
I don't think we should point fingers, because every generation, our religion accepts that. And, you know, religious scholars have even accepted that each generation is supposed to be different. Do not tell your children what you were told as a child, because times are different. So in that way, definitely, we're not blaming anyone, but you're absolutely right, because the entire realm where we're operating in is very different.
Yeah.
Now to say that, when my university time came, when I had to apply for a lot of things as well, And being the first one to go from my family to my university, I was like, I don't know how to do it, because the internet was sort of controlled as well, because my dad was in intelligence, so everyone had, everything had to go through filters. So I was like, Baba, can you help me? Can you, like, I don't know how to apply. Can you do something?
That's generation gap as well.
He did not, exactly. I was, that's what I was. Yeah, yeah. He did not help me. He said, 30 saal pehle mera time tha. Point being, he said, 30 years ago, it would have been my time to enroll in university. It's your time now. Go learn. And I was literally Googling how to register in university. He could have helped me, right?
Yeah.
But that at that moment, I learned things by myself through experience, which I wouldn't have anyway. And now I can guide all of my siblings to do that, because he still doesn't. I have to. Now, with this, I think, sir, you should be better able to explain this. Acceptance is a major factor when age gap is a thing, mm-hmm. and generation gap, sorry.
Yeah.
And generation gap is a thing.
Comes
and acceptance has to come from both the ends, because both are right in their head, like Shahzad said. Do you agree, or is it not that way?
So moving on towards the solutions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, that is here the parents and the teacher roles comes into play, like mm-hmm. To bridge this generation gap.
Mm-hmm.
What I think is, like, I will come to your point later. Let me explain it first, that how we can bridge it first. So, you know, for example, if there is a thinking gap between the parent and the children, his child. So if the parent adopts some of the new technologies, like the new thinking of his next generation, and the next generation tries to understand the parents' thinking, and they're sort of like solving these, approaching to solve the situations,
mm-hmm.
then there could be a win-win situation. Like, you compromise on some things, like understanding your child and his thinking, and your child try to understand your thinking. Like, you win something, you have something that you put, like, what you are thinking, you have something to impose on your child, and your child, like, make you agrees with him up to some extent, then there could be the gap could be narrowed. The gap could be narrowed, and then it's possible. So
exactly.
And now acceptance, like you said, I think you have to meet halfway both of the parties.
Yeah, the halfway of the both of the parties. That's one of the way. That's one of the way.
Uh-huh.
Like, you could. I mean, you move on, like, to cover the gap. Like, you move on, and your. I mean, you move towards one another. Like,
exactly.
Halfway between.
But I partially disagree, and I tend to disagree. It's because of the fact that, you know, when, sir, we talk about generation gaps, you know, nobody talks about the mindset, nobody talks about the cultural values, nobody talks about the morals, because they are intangible. Mm-hmm. You know, this is one thing which we really need to consider. But technology, use of technology, education, all of these things are very out there, tangible, and then anybody and everybody can calculate whether you can use an iPhone or not, whether you can use an iPod or not,
mm-hmm.
you know, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what we do wrong is that we do not consider all of that mindset or the cultural values or the norms we were given to take forward, because that's where the differences occur.
Hmm.
You know, we can use good technology, but they have those morals and values to give to us. And what we do is that we do not kind of abide by all of those morals and cultural norms, and they do not kind of know how to use that technology. I think that's the main difference, if we differentiate. But coming back to the point where they have to come or we have to go, it's not like that. I think that those elderly people are still so gracious that what they do is that they give us the space, they give us the benefit of doubt,
mm-hmm.
and then they're like, okay, yeah, whatever you're saying, we can do that. And alhamdulillah, at my household, the generation gap does not exist, and there's a reason. So for the very first time, when I actually passed my first semester for my bachelor's, I went to my father and I was like, I got a scholarship. I have scored 3.6 GPA. And all of a sudden he was like, oh, you know, what's GPA? And I was like, it's grade point average, and you get it out of 4, and, you know, all of that. And then the next semester, before my result came out, my father has actually enrolled himself into a master's program to know what my children are doing, which I think
so
was great.
Sweet as well.
Even these days, I think my father would know more hacks of iPhone rather than me. So he was always on top of that game that, okay, you know, if my kids are doing something, I shouldn't be left behind. So he took this initiative by himself, rather than us going to him and explaining and telling. He went to universities, he, you know, hired a guy probably to understand all the tech and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And alhamdulillah, we're on the same page. So anything which I tell him, he knows before me. I think it's great, and we communicate. So just another example, Mr. Kriya, I know you have to say something, and that is that just yesterday, I think this is one thing where you can bridge the gap, and that is having dinner together as a family or lunch together. That's something which is, yeah, sitting together. That's important. So I was sitting down and my father was like, okay, you know, you were working with him. What did you do? I was like, you know, I need to actually have real evidence whether that particular guy is making good use of the money. And then only then I will get my contacts to do that. And he was like, yeah, I think that's a brilliant idea and you should actually follow that. So that's how you're going to bridge those gaps, sitting together, discussing, communicating. But that intangible and tangible factor is going to be there still. But ma'am, you wanted to add?
To your point that what you said about your father, that is called power reversal.
Okay.
Okay. Like the parents have to go towards power reversal. They have to consider their children as expert.
Yeah.
And
I think so. I think he might be doing that to us.
Yes, this is to mediate the process, you know.
Yeah.
Because it's not the blame game. It's a function of the normal social change.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Change has to occur. It will upset and it will reset.
True.
And we have to, you know, adjust ourselves with it in order to.
Why do you think we need to go towards the upset point of it? Now that's what the question is.
Change is it's a
inevitable
natural process.
Yes.
Initially it upset and then naturally we get reset with it.
Yeah.
And as Shiza said, like Dr. Sajjad points, we should go for not only for equality but also equity.
Equity. Yeah.
When we think about equity, we are going to highlight the importance of like responsibilities that covers everyone's rights.
Yeah.
Okay.
We are understanding that people can be different.
Like we know that our child needs a bicycle, but we should know which size.
Yeah.
Got it.
Okay.
His feet that's something our parents never knew. You know, I was in fifth grade. I was wearing
shoes. That's Sorab wali cycle.
No. I was wearing when I was in fifth grade. I was wearing shoes where a person would actually wear them to like seventh grade. You know, the take two sizes extra. Yeah, toot jayega. So you have to buy extra.
So,
yeah.
So when we talk about technology, we should not forget equity.
Okay.
Okay.
How in technology though?
Like, give every freedom.
Okay.
Everybody has the right to use the technology, na?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that it's inclusive as well.
You want to bridge the generation gap, but don't forget the equality with equity.
Yeah, exactly. Okay? Wow, that's
wonderful. The other thing to Abdul Wahab point that we are like becoming or we are losing emotions, warmth, because we are totally on this written communication. But just think of the Stone Age.
Ma'am, it's been 2 years, we haven't hugged anyone, you know, we haven't shaken hands, you know, we do feel that,
Shazad,
you know,
all the people
emotion.
That you should hug live
I mean,
at your place.
Boys, the Jaffi is very different,
okay.
You know,
in the Stone Age, when there was no language, when the people used to draw the, you know, pictures on the caves, and this was the only communication.
Exactly.
So
even then they understood each
they
other.
They were communicated to each other. They
exactly.
used to communicate their emotions. So emojis are the sort of communications.
Yeah. But the emojis
now
are
what
most
convenient.
I think most of the time emojis are misunderstood as well. So it's better to write what you mean to say.
Sometimes your body gestures also misunderstood.
Yeah.
Exactly. And we truly get that. But since we are very short on time, Ms. Shukriya, so we actually have to move on to Dr. Abdul Wahab Saab as well.
Yes.
Let me try to find a
You have to wrap it up as well, okay?
Exactly. Let me try to find, find solutions. The thing is, I mean, we understand there are problems created by generation gaps.
Okay.
How to find solutions? As I earlier mentioned, we have, for example, three generations. You see, basically, the problem occurs when we do not give space to others. As said earlier, giving space to others is the most important thing in life. If we do not give space, if we do not give respect, if we do not treat the person with kindness, most of the problems basically generate from that philosophy.
True.
So what we have to do, as I mentioned earlier, the say the generation, I mean, in the shape of grandpa, he doesn't understand technology. Our father understands technology and his perception is mixed. The son, I mean, he understands almost everything very well. As grandpa, I mean, he has to understand that he has lived his life. Now the life is different. Demands are different. Everything has changed, you see. Previously, I mean, for example, just for the sake of example, we call any cab, Kareem or Uber or anyone else, just through a command. It was almost impossible.
True.
So, we have to respect this new generation, we have to try to save them from negativities of the technology.
True.
We have to give them space. We have to really, I mean, educate. We have to introduce sort of morality into it as well.
True.
Ethical education, moral education, with the liberty that they should excel whatever they are doing. You see, so basically, I mean, if you try to fill all the gaps which we witness in our youth, in my opinion, we can really, I mean, solve this riddle.
Exactly, that's wonderful. And sir, this coming from you, I think I 100% agree to it. But one last question, sir, Dr. Sahab, I'll take this one from you, and that is, so my grandfather, may his soul rest in peace as well. Amin. Great, Amin. Great guy.
Amin.
So initially, when it used to get so hot, you know, so my father was like, Abbaji, you know, I want to actually gift an air conditioner to you. He was very against it, all right? But eventually, when it came down into his room, or probably he didn't want to say it, but he was in the mood to reject the offer. And then Abu did it on purpose and went and put an air conditioner in his room. And then my chota chachu, you know, my younger chachu, he was like, Abbaji, I want to gift you a television. And he was very against television. He would only watch PTV, or either he would watch PTV sports as well. So, and then my chachu was like, one day when my dadabu actually went somewhere outside, so he brought in a color television, you know, gave the cable connection to it as well. And now my dada could watch anything. Not that he would watch anything else. He would watch sports and news as well.
Mm-hmm.
But then later on, he was very happy that he was actually up to date with all of latest things which was happening.
So nice.
Why do you think that all of these elderly people are so against all of these newer ideas in the first place? That's the only question from my point of view.
Where does the resistance come?
Yeah, actually the resistance came. There was something in their mind that
it's wrong.
It's wrong. Maybe there is a wrong use or misuse of those things, and this misuse could lead our youth or new generation to the wrong side.
Exactly.
Right. So that was the fear, actually. And you know, to overcome our fears, we should know about some tactics. And they were like lacking in those tactics, like how they were fear that maybe I lose the control on my generation or things like that. So those fears should be overcome.
Exactly. That's thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for joining us. Wonderful to have you, Dr. Sahab. Ms. Shukriya, and Bahab Sahab, thank you very much once again. And we hope, ladies and gentlemen, that we actually made absolute sense over here. Shiza, do you agree?
I mean, I hope.
Yeah, you were hoping?
Yes.
I think we did. But ladies and gentlemen, please make sure that you write to us on our Facebook, Twitter, Instagram pages. And the fabulous repeat's going to be at
5:00 PM tonight.
So the next time, look out for yourselves. Let's do it together. 1, 2, 3. Good morning.
Take care.
Thank you.